Like to introduce Mr. Ajit has worked in multiple multinational companies, APL Logistics. He was MD of Toll Global Logistics. Before that, he was with Mahindra and Mahindra for almost 10 years in supply chain management. And then he started his company, and the TVS Logistics also has worked. So not only multiple companies worked. GRV Junction Agritech Private Limited. He has started with the specific purpose of solving a problem of minimizing the wastage and connecting the farmers for their marketing linkages. This is, he felt very important. They're trying to do this through intervention of technology. They're building this application called Origin Connect. So with this, on this note, we welcome Ajit. Ajit is our archive of our incubator. We are happy that he has associated with Manish. We hope they reach great heights serving the farming community. So over to you, Ajit sir. Thank you.
So thank you, Yuvraj sir, for the kind introduction, and thanks and good afternoon to all the participants. I know that many experts are in this panel, and I'm not looking after sharing only my information, but I'm looking forward to receive a lot of information from the other side of the table also. Because I always believe in sharing. As Yuvraj mentioned, after my BE and MBA finance, almost 29 years of experience, managed leadership role in six companies. Till last year, I was working as the CEO for DP World, which is about 1,000 crores plus Indian revenue for India operation. I think our journey started with this news of the 4th September 2019. And to be frank, I was not having any exposure to the agriculture world. And this is what, as you do early morning, that the Times of India, and then I just read this news that the India's largest problem is agriculture wastage. And that got my attention. And then I thought understanding it in more detail. And before that, I not even planted the Tulsi plant also at home. So absolutely no agricultural background, only the Mumbai guy work in the several countries which are very, very developed. So hardly any touch or roots with the agriculture land. But then this statement was very, very strong. And then I started understanding how exactly it is. It is really right information, or it is information which not really put in right form. So I've gone through several reports. And when I've gone through several reports, I explore, and this is a 2015 report. After that, I'm not able to receive report. But then the farm output of the India is almost 270 million tons, which is substantially more than, almost like a 45 million tons more than the Indian requirement. But the challenge, which is in the lower block of the presentation, is that about 194 million Indians, all brothers and sisters, go hungry every day. And this was confirmed by the UN and the FAO. This is a very shocking news to me, specifically when I have only exposure to cities like Mumbai. I was not absolutely knowing, and this really touched the heart. And then we started understanding the real pain, exactly what is there, why it is happening. And the real reason is that, again, this 40%, 30%, 20%, I think these are all percentages, but the majority of the part of our produce food is getting wastage in such a way that some of the numbers, like 21 million tons of wheat is getting wastage, which is a total production, annual production of country like Australia, which is a very, very upsetting news. 92,000 crore totally getting lost as a agri wastage. Now, these are very, very mind-boggling numbers. And it is very, very challenging that how much we do a green revolution and many other things, but the post-harvest loss is very, very high. The 40% is a number, and of course, there are many debates and different reports, so I'm not going into that area. And that is not the intention, but it's a substantial chunk of the produce agriculture is going into waste. And then I read a lot of reports and different YouTube, and of course learn a lot of from the Google Baba, and learn that, see, these are the different ways, you know, these are different areas where the agri wastage is happening across the whole value chain, right from the part farm that is till the consumer. So the farm handling is, when we say farm handling, is about the cooling, cleaning, sorting, packaging, all activities at source itself, and threshing applicable to few commodities, but storage at source, local transportation, line haul transportation. Line haul means from the far long haul transportation, then the handling. So these are the major source of wastages of agri. And then I read some reports where I found that the major wastage is happening at the farm handling and the storage and transportation. So then we thought that, okay, if this is the major issue, why not to really take that as a problem itself? Because this is all the post-harvest value chain. And if this is having so much impact on what exactly, for the, because if this is going to be a major problem in India, and this is like this, and this is a handling, and of course this is much better photograph, because I've seen several photographs, because after I traveled across India to see what is the reality on the field as well, where how it is getting loaded in the trucks and a lot of waste is happening. In the storage, I visited several stores, and you will not feel that this is a potato. This is a potato which is completely rotten, and there are many warehouses where you will find this kind of situation. So what we have done is that understood that this loss is not only, because we need to categorize that too if you really want to solve the problem. So we see that there's a quality loss, there is a weight loss, and there's a huge opportunity loss, because the farmer is not getting the expected crop price. Now, when I say quality loss, it means as you are taken out of the field, the freshness, the aging happens, and the quality start deteriorating if you don't really keep in the proper warehouse and the transportation. The second loss is a weight, is because all these processes, the weight is getting reduced, and of course because of the dehydration process, the weight of the commodity reduced substantially. So for example, let's say if we load a cargo like, let's say, garlic from the MP, and we bring to, let's say, Coimbatore. Now every day there's almost like a 1.5% of a reduction in the weight happening because of the dehydration. So this is a weight loss. And of course, crop prices is mainly because of the challenges of the demand supply. So when farmer don't get, so there are two problems. Basically, the farmer doesn't get a market. He don't have option but to go to nearby mandi, or somebody who can give cash, or somebody who is reliable as per them, who may be the mukhiya, or somebody who's from the very respected family from the village, or somebody. So very limited choices. And the second thing, they don't have a visibility of what is happening in the market. Now, because of the internet, of course, the situation is changing, and changing very fast, but this is also a big opportunity loss. So when we say the type of losses, these are the major three losses which carries about 95% of the losses. The whole problem of our startup itself. So we started this early last year, and the problem is that post-harvest value chain is highly inefficient. And of course, there are many components of this inefficiency, but we've taken three major components. So one is the crop wastage, which I just discussed. The second thing, there is a huge buyer and seller trust deficit, and that is mainly because of the quality issues. Whatever is getting loaded and whatever is getting unloaded, completely a different perception. And the presenter before me was saying, Sneha was saying, that wheat or whatever the produce, there is no specification specifically for the grading. So for example, let's say if you go to a jeweler, you know that, okay, the 24 carat means this, and this is a price. 22 carat means this, and this is a price, and 18 carat this is a price. So there is no major issue in terms of the perception of the seller and buyer. But this is a very non-standard commodities, and there is always the perception issue. what people buy maybe about 2,000 kilometer away from the source, maybe from the maybe one of the photographs from the WhatsApp, or maybe somebody who is a faithful to them for several years of time, they trust, and then basis of that they decide, okay, you load 25 tons by this rate, and when they receive this after 5 days, they find something completely different, and there the whole distrust started. And that's the situation for the whole value chain. Nobody is trusting anybody. Neither farmer trusts the source trader, neither source trade trusts to the transporter or transporters to the destination trader. Nobody is trusting to the wholesaler or retailer and even the customer. So this is a chain of distrust because of the quality issue, or there is no specification in terms of quality. And of course, the third thing is about the major issues of the demand supply gap. And I use this word bullwhip effect, which is the supply chain term. I cannot help it. I spent about 30 years in supply chain, so can think about only supply chain. But then this is a very, very valid to the rate vagaries, because what is rate is happening in the market today is based on the supply and demand. And when the demand goes up, there is a high rate. And when because of the rate is high, every farmer or the source trader try to push the sale. But till in next 3 to 4 days it reaches there, the demand goes because there's a huge supply. And this bullwhip effect is completely in the whole supply chain and impacting farmers specifically in terms of the variations in the rate. So we've taken these three problems, and I'm not saying these are the only problems, but these are the three major components of the highly inefficient value chain post-harvest. And of course, we thought about this solution, and last almost 15 months, we are working on that. We are still into the minimum value proposition stage, where our whole solution is about optimizing agri value chain globally. And why I say globally? Because we believe that, because since we have surplus in India, and the data says that, we should not only feed our Indians, which is our brothers and sisters, but even we should feel as India, feed to the whole globe. And that is with the vision we have taken this particular venture, where the important thing which we are trying to do is about the mechanized grading process, because of the problems which you mentioned in terms of the grading standards. We also mention challenges in supply chain, so we need to have an efficient supply chain. But not only the efficiency supply chain, but we need to have a end-to-end traceability. I'm purposely not using word visibility, but traceability. So you can trace up to the farmer what is happening, and trace up to the customer what is the feedback of the consumer. And the third is about creating a B2B agri marketplace so that the farmers, the producers and the consumer can get both options. So there is a good quality is available around, can get a better rates. So these are the solution, and I'll go in detail of each of them. But before that, try to share with you the whole market size. Now, again, these numbers also are mainly from the Google or some of the literatures or some of the reports. But then total agri market in India is almost like a $300 billion. Which is increasing almost 11% CAGR. So it is expected to cross 500 billion by 2025. In that, the fresh market, which is the fruit and vegetable, itself is a $75 billion. Now, what we thought that for the minimum viable project, we cannot take this whole into consideration. So let's take maybe a 3 to 4 commodities only. But if we able to solve problems in that, it is highly replicable for the rest of the commodity. So we taken the king of the vegetables, which are the potato, onion, garlic, which is for the masses. And that is normally about 15 to 20% of your expense or a consumption. Any household, if you are buying, let's say 100 kg of fruits and vegetables, at least 10 to 20% based on the pattern will be the potato, onion, garlic. So we've taken that as the only selected part, and the total available market for that itself for India is about $15 billion. And of course, in that also, this is only for the minimum viable product. And once we done do that, which will be we are doing only in three mandis for the next 3 years, and we will spread out to almost 1,000 mandis with the 50 commodity, that itself become the 50 billion market. And I'm not even considering export in this particular number. So the only the message from or the delivery from this particular side is there's a huge market and there's a huge opportunity in this. We started, see, I came from the background where I always believe on the site, because in agriculture or any startup, I think you all have to be on the site, and we started from the source because the real problems is at the source. So what we started doing is collaborating with the farmers and helping them to define the whole methodology about how they pick and how they really bring it to the stores. So we started with the sorting so that all the dirt, all the damaged one is all left here itself. And that itself is about 7 to 10%, which is a substantial number. Of course, we are ready to pay to the farmers, but then we are taking the help to remove at the sourcing stage itself. And by that, what we are trying to do is that if take the 7% out, even though you pay for it, but then you are not allowing the 7% to damage the another 7% in this whole process. So by which this 15% we reduce to 7 itself, and this 7 you sell in the local market itself, because you need to transport a store, because the transportation and the storage cost is almost like a 25 to 50% of the crop. So instead of spending that money on something which is not a good quality, we started separating from there itself, and we saved a lot of money in, or maybe money more than money is a more inefficiencies in this process. The second thing which we have done, and I'm just taking potato as an example, I can talk about same thing for the onion and garlic. We taken that to the store, but then before storing, we started grading that to A, B, and C. Although we defined ourselves what is A, B, and C, because there is no specific standards available. But if that works well, I think that can be replicated to the other mandis also. So this is what the grading machine, which is a mechanical grading machine. We also experimenting on the optical grading machine also, so that the speed of the grading and the quality of the grading and the accuracy of the grading can be further improved. And what we are achieving with this grading is that before it's getting stored, it is very clear, like the Samsung phone, that the Samsung phone is the S21 or S22 or maybe S18. I think we are categorizing that so it can fetch a different value at the marketplace. So we are doing that at the source itself, A category, B category, and C category with the right specification. So somebody who is a buyer, the way they buy jewelry like 24 carat and 22 carat and the 20 carat or 18 carat, there is a price and quality co-relationship. After that, we've seen that major challenge is the cold store itself. Of course, this is one of our cold store which we've taken on the lease for the year, which is in Disa, which is into Gujarat, where we are sourcing currently. This is one of a sourcing point. We are sourcing for Agra and the Gujarat, because our majority of the market is the south. We started with the south four states, where the Gujarat has a more demand. And you can see the quality of the warehouse, which is a three-story inside. And I will show you some photograph. This is like a staircase inside the warehouse. It is a dark picture because we cannot have that much illumination. Although we are putting the lux, what is required. Lux is a unit of light. And it is a temperature control, which is about 4 degrees. So you can see the quality of the warehouse which you are using, by which the product which is going to get stored. Therefore, almost, let's say, 1 month to 8 months, because I think many people may be knowing this, that the harvesting time for the potato is only January, February, March, and half of April. So almost like 8 months, we are consuming the cold store potato. The good part is the availability of infrastructure for the potato is good in India. But then we, for the best, and we did a lot of changes in the warehouse. Is almost like, you know, some of my team member is saying that this is almost like a Oyo of a warehouse, where the Oyo also do take a normal hotel, but then they do the changes as per their standards, and then it become OYO, which gets a more quality and the more hotel tariff as well. So we did few changes based on our supply chain experience, and we stored potato there. From there, we did a lot of experiment, and one of the experiment is that 4 degree temperature storage in the Disa, we are bringing to the south market in a temperature control vehicle, so that whatever is being stored, quality, exactly it is coming same quality with the same freshness in the south market, which is a costly affair. But the challenging part and the very interesting part is that we get a huge preference and we get a better rate by which we can able to manage the extra cost for the quality of the warehousing and the transportation effectively. So we could created almost like a 5% market share in that particular mandi, which is Metropolium, and substantially a good branding that whatever we are buying from GRV, it is a quality product, which is very important in the beginning of the venture. This is the inside photo of a temperature control vehicle, which is about 4 to 7 degrees of the temperature. So these are some of the revenue streams which is started. So we launch our venture incorporated in February, and this is a timeline on which we are working, and it is going exactly as per the timeline so far. These are the few customers we managed to get on the board. These are the very well-known startups, which is almost funded more than 500 crores so far, and these are our customers, and we are their preferred suppliers. So we expect that our growth should happen along with them. And I'm happy to share that in the month of March, we crossed 1,000 tons of our supply to all these customers, including the mandi wholesalers. And in this whole process, we are also educating the wholesalers in the mandi, and they started, and this is our process of offline. And I'll come to the online, because ultimately we are launching our marketplace in the month of June, where it is expected as a B2B that the wholesalers should able to source a better quality and the better rate from the marketplace, which we are going to launch. And we already created our traction with farmers. This is the slide which shows that our progress since our inception, that we are now connected with 185 farmers, about 14 customers are on board. We manage about 22,000 plus bags in the quarter four, and sourcing point and other few numbers. So I thought sharing this with you so that you can get idea about how exactly our team is doing. And this is our warriors. We done a lot of stuff in the COVID-19 itself. Of course, taking not only the care of ourselves, but even the care of the people in the mandi, the people in the farmer. We done some education program for them also, so that they should consistently able to support what we are trying to do. So with this, I will like to conclude my presentation, and happy to take few questions if you have.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your informative presentation. My end, sir, the first question. So even though you explained specifically why you have chosen these three crops due to various reasons, so how much time do you, how many farmers at this point of time you are working with, sir?
So we are connected with 126 farmers, but then okay. What we have done in this whole process of 15 months, the way we are sorting the potato, similarly, we also sorted the farmers, because not that the all farmers could able to support us as per the requirement of our quality. So now currently, okay, although we're connected with 126 farmers, but to be precise, we are working regularly with 75 farmers. Remaining almost 50 farmers we've taken as a standby, because what we thought initially is to start with many and then shortlist and then work with few farmers so that we can have a focus.
Okay, sir. How far is the technical platform is going on, sir? How do you think when you can come with the final final version, or still it is people are onboarding?
No. I think it will go everything as per plan. We started our platform preparation by January and it will get launched in June. The purpose we started late because what my experience, because I manage the global IT roles also in my earlier MNCs, which you mentioned. My experience is that people first start with the IT infrastructure without understanding the process. My belief is that we need to understand process first, establish first, and this process needs to optimize base with the IT. So we first spend time on the ground for 8 to 9 months to really understand what is required, what exactly, what value we can add offline, and then how we can further add value by taking that online. And that's the reason we started in January and we'll be rolling out that from the June onwards.
There is a lot of improvement in the whole supply chain that you have done, like from procuring to up to selling, and there are various costs involved. So is the end consumer ready to pay off for that excessive work that you all are doing? Because some of them are very price conscious buyers.
Sushil, I think it's a great question, and I will give you in the numbers. So the first thing which we explore is that if you just do buy and sell, there is a challenge that you cannot have a consistent profitability. So as a business model, our profitability is going to come and is coming is only from reducing the inefficiencies. So when you are trying to solve a problem, so let's say when you procure, let's say 100 kg, and let's say you lose 20 kg in this whole process, you lose 20 kg of revenue. Again, in the food, nothing is going west. The only challenge is that the 20% will not able to get you the expected revenue. So there is a substantial revenue leakage for that 20%. What we try to do is that the way I mentioned when Yuvraj sir asked me about the farmers, similarly, we went to those customers who value quality. So like the branding, if you see in the customer slide, they value quality and they're ready to pay a very small premium for that, which effectively is going to get a lot larger benefit to the customer. So that is answer number one. The sub part of that answer also is that when you have a good infrastructure like grading, sorting, good warehousing and the transportation, that the freshness of the product is such a high that the consumers are ready to pay at least 5% to 10% of the premium. So for example, let's say if I go to the market to buy, let's say potato, for example, because we talk about that for last 20 minutes. And if I have two lots, the one is, let's say, 20 kg per kilo, and second is the 22 rupees per kg, which is just to 10% extra. Normally, everybody of us will go for 22 if the freshness is very good. People will not mind paying for 2 rupees. So that is my experience in the retail as well as wholesale. But then our products are getting more preference. We don't have to go to market it, so that the marketing cost is reducing. Second thing is they're getting a very small premium, and that is sufficient to recover our additional logistic costs. Is that answer your question, Sushil?
Yes, sir. That is very helpful. Thank you.
Everybody knows that most of the farmers are not very familiar with IT or technology related thing. How do you want to solve this problem, especially related to your particular application?
I traveled extensively in last 1 year, although it was a COVID, but with the right protection, I traveled very extensively. And what I've seen is that 90% of the farmers having the smartphones. Then also I learned that out of this 90%, at least 85% of the farmers are using WhatsApp for sure or Facebook for sure. It means that if they get a value out of that app or technology, they are ready to use. So our hypothesis is that India is ready for the IT products. And the very important point, third point is, I found the mobile network is substantially better than Mumbai and Bangalore and Hyderabad and Chennai and Delhi in the villages. I don't know the technical reasons, but with all these three, our hypothesis is that India is ready for the IT revolution as far as the agri is concerned. Now, if we provide a value, they can ready to use. However, we want that they should not be spending more time in this. So we need to do it as user friendly as possible, so that they can use it very with a very low band connectivity also. If they are not having smartphone also, they should able to use it. And the third is that whatever they are going to use, they should able to get some value. So for example, if I'm a farmer and let's say for my 1 ton, I'm getting 1,000 rupees today, but then by using this application, which we are launching in the June, if they are able to get maybe 100 rupees or 10% extra, I am very sure they will get the, they will use this. So we are not going to give them only options, but we are going to give them a lot of information about the rate, what is happening around the almost 300 mandis across India.
Apart from providing them, I mean, procurement or grading related services, any agronomy support you are providing, sir?
So when we understood that only providing market is a part of solution, or only providing grading, which is quality, also is a part of solution. So what we will be doing is that the way Amazon is doing today, they don't connect the suppliers with the customers, but they ensure the complete ownership of the transportation and logistics. So we are going to do the same thing for our customers, by which farmers and our customers, we will be having the buying power to really support that as number one. Number two, we also seen that lot of challenges the farmers and the customers, and in this our case wholesalers, are facing due to the financial challenges. So now we are tying up with the banks and the NBFCs, where we will be having the bid discounting model so that their financial issues are getting solved. We also experimented last year to few of the farmers to supply seed, so that if you are giving good seed, so that we can get a good quality of the crop. So that also we tried. So there are many models which we're going to try with the MVP, which is going to get completed by end of this year.
So it gives them some kind of advantage in the long term, when especially when you are supporting from advisory services in input level also.
What are the criteria that farmers should have to working under your banner? That means, how can you select the farmer that yes, he is eligible or she is eligible to working under your banner?
Okay, so Dr. Manas, we are not decided the criteria or something at this moment of time, because we just started our venture last year. What we are trying to do, and I answered this question in the part way when Yura sir asked me how many farmers. So we already connected with 126 farmers in this year. But then when we seen that in spite of giving good seed, very few of them, maybe 75% of them only could able to produce good quality of potato. So when we seen this, next time we are not going to give it to 126, we will focus more on the 75 farmers only. Now why? Because instead of spreading to have this maybe number of farmers, let's say 1 million or 2 million, which most of the startups are doing currently, I think what we believe is that we believe in focus. We will focus on the very few commodities. We will focus on the very few farmers. We will focus on the few markets. But what we do is that we will go very deep dive, so that we can able to extract the value out of the optimization, by which the farmer also gain, the customer also gain, and our venture GRV Junction Agritech Private Limited also will get.
Sir, another question is that due to the lack of cold storage or a warehouse, so percentage of wastage of agricultural product is more. So you are talking about that cold storage or warehouse. So you have taken it as a tender from the government, or you're yourself building that your infrastructure. Unable to have facilities of cold storage or warehouse.
Correct. So now, if you talk about the storage, your understanding is absolutely correct, Dr. Manas. That and which I mentioned in earlier slide also, that in the farm related activity on the site as well as in supply chain, the major loss is happening. And when I say supply chain, the storage and transportation is a part of that. So you are right that today we have a infrastructure challenges across India. However, we need to divide this storage into two parts. One is the normal warehouse, and second is the cold rooms. Now, the cold rooms are dedicated to few of the commodities, but when we talking about the potato, which we started, we taken as that as a one commodity for the MVP. Fortunately, there are 3,000 cold rooms are currently available across India. So there is no shortage of the cold room for the potato. And the government also is doing lot of support, financial support for the somebody who wants to build the cold rooms as well as the warehouses. There's a huge subsidy. I'm not expert in that area, but you can check. But there are a lot of subsidies available for building the storage. Now, answer to your another part of the question is that are we building something? No. At this stage, we are not building something. But what we have done is that we taken a 1 year lease, which is a quality warehouse, and we done some technical changes in that warehouse to ensure that the 4 degrees are maintained for all 8 months in spite of the availability of cargo. So that we have done. So our model is not to do the very capital intensive model. We will go always with the variable costing. Our investment will be mainly into the development of the research and development, which is for the grading machine, IT development for the creating B2B agri marketplace, as well as the people who should be there as a Mandi Mitra and the Kisan Mitra to coordinate with the farmers and our customers to get them on the market.
Excuse me, sir. I am from Kashmir, J&K UT. I do horticulture crops. So how can we take this initiative to the fruit growing sector and industry? A lot of post-harvest losses.
Correct. So, Dr. Nisar, your question is absolutely correct. What we are trying to do is that establishing our the minimum viable product. And this is the second year of our venture. We able to successfully do it for the potato, garlic, and onion in this year. Our few of the pieces in the supply chain is still under implementation. As I mentioned in the slide of the market, where the total market which we are talking about, it is more than the 75 billion. Now, what we will do that once we establish our model, and when I say establish means when people customer can able to and farmer can able to trade by using our B2B agri marketplace, then we will add more commodities and we will go to the fruits also. But at this stage, maybe possibly I am not a person who can able to answer your question about the fruit. I understand there is a problem and we are building solution. Once we complete with these three, we will get more commodity inside, including fruits.
We have done something here. We have done, for example, for walnut, we have developed some machines like walnut huller, walnut, these, what we can do so that to minimize those post-harvest losses. We have done that. So, but I think there is a huge demand of research into how can we deal with those perishable items like cherry, like strawberry. This is a very demanding subject.
Absolutely. So I think that's why I mentioned in my first 5 minutes is that this platform is not to get the input from the speaker, but there are many experts in this audience, and we always can learn from each other. So, doctor, what I will do is that I will take your contact details from the manage, and I'll engage you to understand some of the innovations which you are doing in your area and your scope of work. And there's a possibility of we can how we can co-collaborate with each other.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
the fruits like strawberries, they are canned in a syrup solutions and they are maintained for year together because it is disposable within 24 hours only. So there is no problem and that can be stored in syrups now. And that is a regular practice where the Maharashtra professionals and Gujarat professionals are doing years together.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely, sir. Basically, brine and syrups, these are the main, these are the things which are now being used for keeping the shelf life of these commodities to elaborate them, to get their elongation period. I mean to say, we can store them for a longer period, and especially during canning, after canning them, like mushrooms.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ajit, for interesting presentation and all the best for your work. Happy to see you today here, and thank you very much.
Thank you.